Thank you for joining us for the third edition of our UC Blue Ash College Entrepreneur Speaker Series. This series is designed to celebrate entrepreneurship and provide amazing insight in some good stories directly from some of the most successful business people in our region. Tonight's special guest, Craig Kurz, is a third generation founding family member of the HoneyBaked Ham Company, the nation's oldest and largest specialty ham retailer. As president of the National HoneyBaked Ham Board of Directors for the past 12 years, Craig has brought strong strategic planning and a vision for the national brand, consumer insight, and brand experience to the company. His leadership has been widely recognized as a key part of the success of HoneyBaked Ham. Please join me in welcoming Craig Kurz. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Monica. So, Craig, why don't you share just a little bit about, you know, how it all got started and the history and your involvement, and we'll kind of go from there.
Okay, Kent, thank you. And thank you again for being here. It's wonderful to share a story that I'm really, truly blessed to be a part of. My grandpa, when you talk about entrepreneurship, it's part of our family's DNA. My grandpa, in 1937, started sketching what he thought could be a spiral slicing machine, revolutionary, an innovation that would spiral slice a bone-in ham around the bone. But the best kept secret is that he was not gonna get in the ham business, he was gonna get in the machine business. So when you think about entrepreneurship and you think about, I have this idea and I'm passionate about the idea and I'm gonna be persistent in that idea, and he was persistent because what his concept was to sell the spiral slicer or license the spiral slicing machine to meat companies who were already making hams. Rejection letter after rejection letter after rejection letter, literally over two decades. What ended up happening, a couple of them said, come back when you got a patent. In 1949, he gets a first patent. In 1952, he gets a second patent. Nobody wants that machine. It is revolutionary. He built a prototype in my mom's basement in Detroit, Michigan, had people videotape it at the time, but film it at the time, and authorize it and saying, I saw Harry spiral slice a ham in his basement on this day, and this was in the 30s and 40s. So persistence as an entrepreneur is really a foundational part of the DNA. So when you talk about our family, it really is part of our DNA. So once nobody wanted that spiral slicing machine that was patented and unique in the industry, took a second mortgage on his house, $500 out of his pocket, and opened the first HoneyBaked Ham store in 1957 in Detroit. So 20 years of persistence to really shift and go into the ham business. And what he also did, because he was very creative and very passionate about the business, he didn't just put any ham on that spiral slicer. We had extended cook and smoking cycles. He put what is considered today the specifications for the most premium ham in the category. And, oh, by the way, he added another touch of innovation, and that's a crunchy, spicy glaze, sweet, spicy glaze, that is very, very unique to the HoneyBaked Ham to this day, some 58 years later. So the smoking, baking, so the patent expired in 1981, his unique invention, but the brand has continued and exploded literally in the 80s after the competitors that he sent letters to and rejected them all got in the category and started throwing hams in a bin that happened to be spiral sliced. So my parents saw opportunity, took the risk, again, creativity, added a lot of products to the mix in the first store in Cleveland, Ohio, which was the second store in the country in 1966. So that's what I grew up with, was parents that had the creativity, the drive to change, the drive to continue to grow and improve the business. And they did it in a very, very strong, hands-on, family-oriented cultural way.
Well, Craig, once they established that second location, the second store, what were some of the challenges that they faced at that point, knowing that it took so long mm-hmm. to get to that level? Mm-hmm. What did they do from that point on?
Well, it's an all-hands-on-deck kind of business. They added products. It was then and still is today a very cyclical business. We do about 80% of our business in November, December, and Easter. So what do you do the rest of the year? You try to sell other products, you try to introduce new products, and that's what my parents did. They would hand-cut steaks, they would hand-smoke bacon in the store, in that original store. They added stuffed turkey chicken breast. They added products to try to drive additional people in, because that big ham at the holiday table is still an icon and was then, and people lined up, fortunately. And they saw the vision that they could bring more people in at that time. And that was, again, another takeaway that I still to this day take with me, is that we need to continue to innovate on adding new products, new reasons for people to shop our stores more often.
You know, you talk about lineup. I remember here in Cincinnati, the store on Montgomery Road, where you really did have to line up at the mm-hmm. holidays to get a ham or to get a turkey at that time. Right. And the lines were, way up the street. Mm-hmm. So, but you don't have that anymore. How did you get away from doing that? I know you've been innovative and trying to prevent people from having to wait an hour, hour and a mm-hmm. half, 2 hours mm-hmm. to get their ham.
Well, again, I go back to innovation and trying to continue to expand the business in the right way with the resources that you have. And my parents back in the 90s sought to expand the business through partnerships. And we tested a concept in Minneapolis with a high-end grocer up there to go where the people were shopping for hams. And that test proved as a foundational point, which brought us back to Cincinnati, fast forward to 2007, and we started what we call kiosk or pop-up retail on a seasonal basis, so that you can expand the brand when people want it, and you can kind of close that tent and pull it back. And we do it efficiently, we do it effectively, and one of the most important things for us is that brand experience that you would get going in my store is the same experience that you're going to get if you go to a kiosk. It's our people, it's the freshness of the ham, we present the ham, it's our equipment, and we've got partnerships such as Kroger's here in town that have provided us an opportunity to extend the brand. And again, that's another way to say, how are we going to grow this brand efficiently, effectively reach new people, and do it in a way that still supports our gold standard quality and service.
Just out of curiosity, how many people in the audience have actually had honey-baked ham? Raise your hand. Oh, my goodness. Look at that.
I like that.
Look at that.
Thank you.
You can't deny it. It is a wonderful product. There's no question about that. So when did you actually get into the business then, mm-hmm. Craig?
I got into the business in 1984. At the time, there were about 80 stores across the country. There was no catalog or, of course, e-commerce, fast forward to today. It was a ham, seasonal ham store concept, bricks and mortar, but we were growing. When the brand, when the patent expired and the competition came in and started loading up and running full-page ads saying, go here, it's more convenient. What that really created for us and for me coming out of college was the difference between a ham with a trademark on it and a brand. And a brand has an emotional connection, a brand that you can really convey and have a consumer really talk about it in a very personal and emotional way. So that's really the elevation of the brand in the 80s. I was very fortunate that 1980 to 1989 was the fastest bricks and mortar growth in the history of our business. And that was the same time that the competition came on board. But we did it because we did it with the right standards, and we did it because we reached people, we listened to people, and continued to follow our brand promise.
Well, competition obviously is always a challenge. So
yes.
Who out there is really your primary competition in the business?
It literally is the hams that are in the grocery stores. That's the most accessible products. They offer a range of sizes and pricing. And that the you can name any of the brands there, from the Hormels and Smithfields of the world to the Paula Deen ham that was out with a secret sauce that she had in a little packet there. But when we continue to do annual brand research, our brand is significantly higher in terms of the standard in the category. It sets the standard, and we continue to work on that every single day.
So you mentioned that you went from really only two stores to about 80 stores in a relatively short period of time. Now, how did you expand that quickly?
That was really my parents and the other family members got involved. So my parents in 66 started getting involved. And then my grandpa's other daughters and son-in-laws, my grandpa had four daughters and the other son-in-laws, I think they started noticing that we opened our second store in, I believe, 1971 or something like that, 72. And they started noticing, so they jumped in the early to mid 70s, and we established regional offices. So there was an office in Michigan, an office that was ours up in Northern Ohio at the time, one in Atlanta and one in Boston. So we had separate family entities that started to grow the business, and that's in many respects, we licensed each territory to each of the families, and that's when they said, we're going to grow through bricks and mortar and have a brand presence across the country.
So the other family members, I mean, that's obviously a challenge. You know, when you have four siblings,
yes,
who are married, who decide, well, maybe we'd like to be in this business too, mm-hmm, you know. How did you manage all that? I mean, that's got to be really difficult to do.
It was difficult. And family businesses, if you look at statistics, going from second generation, my parents' generation, to my generation, the success rate is about 10 to 12%. Handing it off as a family-owned business from third to fourth is 3 to 4%. And a lot of it has to do with the family complexities. And in our situation, we had separate entities. We had separate companies. So if I didn't want to do what my cousin was doing or my aunt and uncle in a different territory, we just say, no, we don't want to do that. We're going to run our territory like this. We had brand standards. We had quality standards. We had service standards. But there was things that were going on differently. And we just, if we did disagreed, we would say, no, I'm not going to do that. You do that. My priority is this.
Okay. entrepreneurship is really, in my mind, it's a mindset, you know. You basically, there are four things, and I tell my students this a lot. I try to get the message across anyway. It's about innovation. It's about creativity. It's about passion. And it's about the willingness to take risk. Sometimes that fourth component is the one that many times is lacking. You know, the willingness to take a risk. Obviously, in your situation, your family situation, you were willing to take risk and probably some major risks. Can you elaborate on any of those, what they might have been?
Well, anytime you make an investment and you put your heart and soul into it, you have to have a plan. And in our case, a lot of what we were able to do was to evolve the concept from a seasonal ham store to cafes. That was extending the brand, and that was risky because you're adding people, you're increasing your cost of goods, you're increasing the space requirements in some respects, so that was risky. But you test and learn, and in our case, we did that quite a bit. For example, the other concept was we took a risk in 2002 when the three of the families got together and bought the second largest specialty ham company in the country, which happened to be all franchised, 200 locations, called Heavenly Ham. Big risk. You're
Very
putting
big risk.
Debt on your books. You're getting into the franchise business, which we were not in. We were in the corporate-owned business where we ran our stores from top to bottom and bottom to top. And here you've got outside investors, and they're putting money into the business. So big risk, but now we have a very successful, since 2002, successful and passionate and growing franchise business.
Yeah, expand a little bit on the franchising concept, because, you know, many times it's the feeling that you have to start a business from scratch to be an entrepreneur, mm-hmm, when you really don't. I mean, going into a franchise is risky, but it's also a way potentially to follow a model that's been proven. Mm-hmm. So obviously it's been successful in the case of HoneyBaked Ham. Now, you acquired 200 locations that were primary franchises.
Right.
But you've expanded upon that, I'm sure, have you not, with your own franchise?
We have, and it actually gave us, you talk about challenges, the question earlier, when the financial crisis hit in 8, 9, and 10, we had stores that were corporate-owned that were not profitable. If we were not in the franchise business, we probably would have just closed those stores. We had the opportunity, and we conducted 9 transactions that sold a corporate store that was either losing money or just about to tank into the franchise business, and immediately those stores started generating royalty revenue. We had passionate people, so it allowed us an avenue to take a corporate store that we likely would have just shut the doors and moved it into franchise. We have very passionate franchisees. They bought into the brand. They know it's the gold standard. We hold them to gold standard service and quality measures. And it's the franchise business is going to continue to grow very, very nicely.
You know, one of the things that we talk about in my entrepreneurship class many times, or even outside of the class, that entrepreneurship is something that you really can't teach, which I tend to disagree with that. Mm-hmm. I think there's some basic parameters upon which you can really help students understand the challenges of entrepreneurship. What's your feeling about entrepreneurship and the ability to really teach it in some fashion? Yeah.
I absolutely think you have to teach it. I think that's it's not just something that just happens. I think there's principles around it. I think there's learning, just like this event here, where you can share questions and answers and what works and what doesn't work. I think the one thing that you referenced earlier, Kent, was it starts with passion. I think, in my mind, it starts with an idea and a plan for that idea. I think oftentimes entrepreneurs don't put the math to it or redo the math as they evolve it. I think doing that adds a fundamental minimizing of the risk. But I think you have to teach the principles of it. And one thing I have always been a fan of is while you're in high school or college, internships, expose yourself to other businesses, expose yourself to even unrelated businesses so you see how other people are operating and taking their idea to market and making it a fundamentally sound idea.
You know, you hit on a key point when you talked about putting the numbers to the paper. That I've found is the hardest thing for anybody, but it's really hard for students because it's like the hockey stick. You know, we're going to be profitable in that very first year. Yeah. And I say, no, you're not going to be profitable in year one. You're not going to be profitable in year two. Maybe you'll be break even in year three. Mm-hmm. But they don't understand that, you know, because they're optimistic, you know, and I don't, right. I understand that. But I try to make that point very, very important because they all want to say, gee, we're going to come right out of the box and be a profitable right. business. What's your feeling about that?
I think that's absolutely the case. That's where if you just lead with your heart, and I think that's a foundational element is leading with your heart. You have to be passionate about it. But you got to also lead with your head, and you got to do the math. And you got to have a plan, and you got to have a plan for minimizing some of the risk if this happens. My philosophy is a plan, do, study, act. So if I'm going to test something, for example, our kiosk program, the first thing we did was we tested one kiosk. We didn't go in 30 Krogers or 10 Bigs. We tested one. We learned what worked. We learned the math. We went through a couple of sales cycles. And then we said, okay, now we'll add, and now you got a program that's got hundreds of kiosks across the country.
Well, Craig, we want to thank you so much. Do you have any last words of wisdom that you want to share before we conclude and actually go out and eat some good honey-baked ham sandwiches?
Well, I again, appreciate you being here. Everyone has ideas. Follow the ideas with a passion. Learn and grow. Never, ever, my guiding principle is never stop learning. To this day, what I learned yesterday, I recognize it. what I'm going to do tomorrow, I'm going to learn and grow. And I'm going to open doors for new opportunities for myself to learn new skill sets. I didn't know what technology was. I wasn't a finance guy. I didn't manage people. You have to be open to change. You have to be open to learning, growth, and personal and professional development.
That's great. Thank you very much. Let's give Greg a round of applause.
Thank you.